So welcome, everybody. This session is about open educational resources, but we're going to focus specifically on equity. This is a panel presentation, so we have just a few slides to frame the issue. And then we have some questions that we're going to ask each other. But then we also are eager to take questions from you and have a discussion, which is great. We have a small room, a small group, and a bit of time. So as we're talking, please start thinking of some of your questions, and then we'll have a conversation as we go forward. So the frame that we've decided to use for this discussion are the Sustainable Development Goals that we all know about and all of our countries are working toward. And specifically, we're looking at goal number 4. And for obvious reasons, goal 4 is about education. The other reason we're looking at goal 4 is the World OER Congress, which will be in Slovenia this September, is also using goal 4 of the SDGs as a focus point. And the conversation that we are having as a global open education community is how can open education in general and open education resources specifically help countries meet the targets in goal 4. So that's part of the conversation that's already underway. That's the frame we've chosen to use today. So just to state a few obvious things, every country in the world, it doesn't matter where you are, education is something that we want for the citizens of our country. Especially when we're dealing in pluralistic, democratic nations, it's something that we want everybody to have equitable and fair access to, because we want opportunities for all of the citizens in our country, in our regions. And we know that one of the best ways to provide opportunities to individuals is through education. Without an education, it's very difficult to get jobs that you might want to have. It's very difficult to be active citizens in a democracy or in government. It's difficult to analyze information and provide input. So this is something that every nation wants for its citizens. If you're not familiar with Goal 4, just a few of the general ideas that are embedded in it. Ensure that all girls and boys complete free, equitable, primary, secondary education leading to relevant and effective learning outcomes. Ensuring that all learners acquire knowledge and skills needed to promote sustainable development. Ensure equal access for all women and men, et cetera, to educational opportunities. We'll talk more about these in a moment. So as we discussed yesterday, we live in interesting times when we have the internet plus educational resources being digital plus open licensing. And that's allowed us for the last 15 years to have this conversation about open educational resources. When this idea was first explained to me, I didn't quite understand the power of this. And somebody finally took me by the shoulders and shook me and said, Cable, there are many people in the world that don't have enough food. Yes? And I said, sure. It's unfortunate. There are a lot of people that don't have enough to eat. He said, well, what if we had a food machine? And you could turn on the food machine, and the marginal cost of feeding each additional person was almost zero. Should we turn on the food machine? That's the question. And I said, well, of course you should. If the marginal cost is zero, you should feed everybody that you can. And it's essentially what we have here is an education resources machine. We never, before 15 years ago, we didn't have this. The production of physical materials, the distribution of physical materials, the copying of physical materials was very, very expensive. But that's not the case anymore. So we talked yesterday about how by open we mean free plus permissions. And when we look at the Sustainable Development Goals, yes, we're absolutely talking about SDG number 4 and getting access to quality education. But we also need to look at other sustainable development goals as well. So industry, innovation, and infrastructure, we've got to have the bandwidth, you've got to have the telecommunications, you've got to have the devices if you want to fully leverage digital content and digital education opportunities. Obviously, you don't have this everywhere today. We can still print OER. There are many, many programs across Africa in particular, and some in Southeast Asia, where we're putting OER on DVDs and shipping them via caravans to villages that may not have internet yet. So there's still ways to move OER around, but to really leverage the efficiencies, we need networks, we need devices, we need digital. One last slide, and then we're going to start talking as a panel. Some of the things that I didn't have a chance to talk about yesterday are, what does the research actually show that happens when institutions move to using open educational resources? And these are the things that happen. First, access goes up, and by definition, equitable access to educational resources follows. And so just to state the obvious, and it's not obvious to most people because we don't think about it, but in countries where the students have to buy the textbooks or other educational resources at the university, which is not all countries, but it's most countries, in those countries, approximately two-thirds of students do not buy the resources that are designed and required for the class, usually because of cost. And so we have, and that's even people that have the money to buy the books. It gets even worse when you are someone who doesn't have very much money, and you're making tough choices between whether or not you pay for rent or childcare or fix your car or buy a chemistry textbook. Their ratios go even higher. And so when you move to OER, when you shift to open textbooks, open curriculum, open degrees, you immediately have 100% of your students on day one having all of the resources that the faculty or the teachers have designed for that course. And when that happens, these things follow. So the teachers, the professors, have current, relevant, effective, quality content for their course. Why? Because they've designed it to be that way. They may not have been the authors, but they revised the content. They remixed it. They put it in the right order. Maybe it needed to be translated into a local dialect, but they know what their students need in their classroom. And because they've got the legal rights and it's digital and they can technically modify it, what they're producing is exactly what they want for their class. So that makes the faculty and the teachers really happy. It also makes the students happy because now the students have a resource that makes sense and the teacher likes it. These are actually the hard research outcomes. One of the things we see is learning outcomes go up. And in subjects like developmental math and developmental writing and English, where people were struggling with a particular subject, they go up by as many as 35 to 45 percentage points. So it's significant gains. And the main reason, frankly, is this. Is if you don't have the resources that were designed for the course, it's very difficult to succeed in the course. I mean, imagine trying to take a college course and doing it without the textbook or doing it without the educational resources that you need to learn. It's a very difficult task. And so, big surprise, learning outcomes go up. Interesting things happen here as well. The time to degree, so we all in your universities would like students very much to graduate in as short as of a time period as possible. And we don't want them to stay in college forever, right? We want them to get their degrees, get their certificates, get out into the workforce and contribute to the economy, contribute to society. Time to degree drops because when students have access, there's equitable access to resources, then people have what they need to be successful in the class, they get the credits, and they move on, and they go to the next thing. The other thing that happens is course dropout rates fall. So these things go together, right? If you're not dropping out of a course, you're finishing the course, which means you graduate faster. So course dropout rates fall on average approximately 15%. So that doesn't sound like a lot. It's a lot. 15% of your students are tipping point numbers. That's a big deal. The other interesting, I don't have it up here, but the other interesting thing that happens is when course dropout rates fall, colleges and universities bring in increased tuition. So in many countries, you charge per credit hour when students are taking credits. Now, there's different systems, I realize that. Sometimes students are fully funded, sometimes you pay full-time tuition, you take as many credits as you want, but in many cases, especially part-time students are paying per credit hour. Now, if they drop out, so if they get into week 7 or 8 of the course and they drop out, the convention is that they don't pay tuition. When you move to OER and people have everything they need, 15% fewer of them are dropping out of the courses, and that means 15% more tuition to the university or college that they wouldn't have otherwise received. And so one of the virtuous loops we're starting to see is shift a course to OER, earn 15% more tuition money, take that money and reinvest it in more courses moving to OER. So this is something that more and more universities and colleges are doing. And then we talked a little bit about open praxis and pedagogy, but students start to become producers of knowledge, and the knowledge is openly licensed and shared everywhere. Okay, so enough of the intro on equity. Let me, gentlemen, would you swing your chairs around? And I'm going to hand you a mic up. Here you go, Joe.
Thank you.
Sure. And how are you? Let me bring up my questions here. Yeah, we can turn that off. So, Joe, first question to you. And well, first let me ask my colleagues to introduce themselves. Joe, you want to go first?
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much. I'm very grateful to the organizers for choosing this theme, and I'm very thankful that you are here, and this reflects your curiosity about the equity dimension of education. And I know that there are many other choices out there with the parallel sessions, all the tools and ideas. So I appreciate very much you're here. My name is Joe Hironaka. I'm from UNESCO. My background is principally in the natural sciences and humanitarian response. I'm not an educationalist, but I'm very pleased to speak about the SDGs and about OER.
Hello, my name is Alek Tarkowski. I come from Poland, where I run a civil society organization called Centrum Cyfrowe, the Digital Center. I'm a policy activist. I've been working on open education policies for around 5 years. And my longer term background in these issues is that I've been working with Creative Commons, running the Creative Commons Poland team for a decade by now. So I also come to education from slightly different perspective. My interest is in management of resources, but as you will see, I also try to look at it from a broader perspective, and I'm very happy to be here.
And I met you briefly yesterday. My name's Cable Green. I'm the director of open education at Creative Commons. I've been there 6 years. For the 25 years before that, I was things like director of e-learning and director of academic technology. And my background and doctorate is in education psychology. So I'm interested in how people learn with technology in the open. So Joe, the first question is to you. Why are the sustainable development goals so important? Why is this an area that we're focusing on in open education? Could you talk a little bit about what nations have actually agreed to? And then talk, we used to have Millennium Development Goals. Right. Now we have Sustainable Development Goals. And are there any differences between those?
Right. Okay, well, thank you for that question. From a UNESCO perspective, when we think about the equity dimension of education, we think of one tool, which is the Sustainable Development Goals. You may not think of it as a tool. You might think of it, honestly, as some sort of model UN type of abstraction, but what's unique about the SDGs is that it includes a large number of indicators that really flesh out some of the inequality issues that were not readily apparent before. Regarding the Millennium Development Goals, it's somewhat curious because the Millennium Development Goals drop some of the issues that had existed in the previous incarnation, which calls the education for all. It did not address quality or equity in a very serious way. You may wonder, well, these are 2030 targets. What do they mean for us? And one way to answer that question is that, or at least alleviate some of the cynicism, is that even the Millennium Development Goals, despite its flaws, had considerable success, on paper, in the aggregate, which is to say that, for instance, the age group of 15 to 24, young adults, literacy rates rose to 90%. That leaves still more than 100 million illiterates. As for primary, we saw a cut by half, approximately half. Now, there are now 57 million out-of-school children in the primary grades. So the challenges remain, but arguably without these international commitments, it may have been more difficult to achieve these goals. So let me give you just a very, very brief sort of aide-memoire about what the SDGs are. The Sustainable Development Goals were adopted by 136 heads of state were at the SDG summit. As you would guess, it's not easy to get that many people into a room. It was adopted universally. There were more than 9,000 delegates at the meeting. This was in September of 2015. One key distinction about the SDGs is it's not legally binding. It's not legally binding. But I think one analog we can compare it to is the Universal Declaration on Human Rights. You may not know this about it's a bit of UN trivia, but a declaration is the weakest of the three normative international frameworks that exist. You have declarations like the human rights. You have recommendations like the UNESCO recommendation on the status of teachers, and you have conventions at the highest level, the World Heritage Convention, for instance, World Heritage Sites, which you may be familiar with. However, when you look at the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which is a mere declaration, it's become basically a universal document simply because nations adopted legislation in support of it. And how is that analogous to the SDGs? Well, one can say at the very least that the SDGs require a level of reporting. In the case of SDG 4, 27 different indicators. And these indicators were designed specifically to flush out disaggregate and flush out some of the interesting information that's hidden behind these aggregate numbers for especially on the issues of equity. And I think that and it requires member states to report on them, you know. And these are incentives that go far beyond. I mean, as you might know, those of you who are in the OER community, two of the foundational documents for OER is the 2007 Cape Town declaration with I believe 3,000 signatories or roughly, and the 2012 UNESCO the Paris Declaration, and which is known, I suppose, the most operative paragraph is the one that says public money, taxpayers' money, should be spent on open license products. We should not double tax the taxpayer first paying for a product and then paying again to be able to access it, taxpayers and institutions. So while these things carry some strength, an alignment to something like the Sustainable Development Goals provides an opportunity to really move forward with OER. And at the risk of being worried, I'll stop here, but you can see even from Cable's demonstration just how the language and the vocabulary of OER aligns and very clearly could support outcomes in the SDGs.
Thanks, Joe. I'm going to come back to you in a moment and talk specifically about some of the points in SDG 4, but let me shift over to Alek for a minute. Alek, one of my favorite stories and examples that I give when I'm talking about equity and open educational resources is the project that you ran in Poland about for textbooks for primary school children. So I'm wondering if you could just tell that story to us. Talk to us about what the project is, why you did it, why there were equity issues, how you solved them, why it's openly licensed. Kind of tell us what you did and how it went after equity.
So first I need to mention that I wasn't running directly the project. I was involved in it, but it was a governmental project, and I participated in it first in the capacity of an expert in the Prime Minister's office, and later as a civil society organization, which sort of was present in the process, which was a five-long process. Also, I talked a bit about it in this session yesterday, so I apologize to those of you who already heard this anecdotes repeated twice or not interesting anymore. But so, the discussion in Poland about introducing open textbooks sort of had two sources. One was not an equity source. It was rooted in a very basic digital education debate on ICT in schools, and this very traditional approach that you just need to provide things like equipment into schools. And this was the initial digital school program that was designed in 2010. It was Poland's sort of third wave of putting computers into school, and the initial idea was, let's buy more equipment. And I don't think that was an equity approach. I think this was an attempt at a modernization approach, and one that I found pretty critical. I've been criticizing while in the Prime Minister's office this idea that you do digital just by putting equipment as much as you can. So, but there is also an equity issue in Poland, and this all concerns K-12, so this is a different level than the one you discussed, and I think this is important. Poland was at that time a country where textbooks were fully purchased by parents, and data has shown that this was an significant cost, especially for poorer families. Of course, it wouldn't lead anyone to drop out. This is not the model. Elementary obligations, education is obligatory, but it would cause different challenges for families with making ends meet. And at the same time, there was a sense that the publishing model is broken. It's a situation that was, for instance, very similar to if you follow debates with open access and scientific publishing. I think we had basically the same sort of discussions that we're getting some sort of an oligopoly that's basically controlling prices, and these prices are increasing. We were able to prove that they increase at a rate that's higher than the inflation rate, that they have profit margins that are higher than the whole publishing industry average. So these were signs that, you know, in principle, there's nothing wrong with profit margins in a commercial enterprise, but these margins were sort of affecting issues like access to education. So putting these two things together, the government designed a program which was called the Digital School, which had four components. It included still the equipment purchasing component, but it added to it open resources, teacher training, and access, online broadband access. And just to focus on the open resources component, over 5 years, it led to the creation of an online national repository that provided access to 60 digital textbooks, covering the whole core curriculum for grades 1 to 12, so all of primary and lower secondary education. And we'll not go into details, but the platform is more or less based on connections code, but it was highly developed. It's modular. I think it's mobile ready, so it's I think a pretty advanced technology. It's not just PDF files. So what's significant there is that there's a very strong sort of open model behind it, which is based on three elements. So there's Creative Commons attribution licensing to provide the strongest possible freedom to access and reuse the content. But furthermore, there's an open format requirement. So we decided that the technical aspect is very important. This cannot be a formal rule, but we need to make sure that we do as much as possible that in practice these resources will be available. And using open formats is one way of doing it. So the rule says that the content can be released in any proprietary formats as long as one of them is an open one. So one where the standard for the format is freely available. And the third rule had to do with accessibility issues, and I think that's one important factor I want to introduce here. We believe in Poland that open education connects very well with sort of sensitivity to accessibility issues with people with all sorts of disabilities, and we try to treat them very broadly in all forms of challenges to accessing content and digital technology. So basically for online resources, the WCAG standard was defined as the one that has to be met. So I'm mentioning that because I think it's good to point that it's more than licensing. One point I want to make, and I think this is different than with higher education, and it has to do with funding models for textbooks, that in the end, the issue of open education in Poland was combined with a shift with public funding of textbooks. And that's, to be honest, also a very important factor which changes the equity situation. And in Europe, the dominant model is that the state usually funds textbooks, usually at least in primary education, usually in high schools. This model changed. Sometimes they're partially subsidized, partially they're not at all subsidized. So when there is public funding, 100% funding for textbooks, you could make an argument that that solves the problem. But I don't think that's true. I will just talk about it in a moment, but I also want to note that the moment this funding stops, it really becomes a significant issue how these textbooks are funded. And the idea of open educational resources really flips sort of this situation, and Cable described this very well. And this works not just for higher education, for colleges and universities, but also for places like high schools that unless you provide public funding for these core resources, and usually this funding is not provided because budgets are limited, then open resources are the solution that solves the problem of access to resources. And the second point I want to make that we believe in Poland that it's not fair to say that if tech content is publicly funded, that solves the issue and we don't need to worry about openness. There are two reasons for that. I think one reason is that the educational system needs to be very aware how it's spending funding. All over Europe, educational budgets are strained. We have been collaborating and discussing this issue with the International Education International, the International Teachers Union, and its European branch, E2C. I think a representative of it is here at the conference. Oh, you're here. Hello. And we know you're very keen on this so-called anti-privatization issue, so you're keen on how funds are managed in education. I'd be very willing to hear more about that. The way I understand it is that the issue of funding of resources and the cost, for instance, public systems have to make to buy commercial resources is one example of that, where no one is saying that these resources should not be purchased, but from the point of view of a public budget, you need to be aware how much you're spending. And I think this is where the open model comes in. Even if you're spending public money, there are some good evidence that it's smarter to spend its money on creation of public content than on purchase of commercial content. What we know from Poland is, of course, creating this public content is not easy. We sort of started from scratch. There have been challenges, I need to mention that. I'm not from the government, so I can say that I think the government has been creating some resources and there's varied effectiveness of that. But I think this can be improved and there are good practices how to do it. And I think also a very good model is to purchase content but with an open licensing requirement. This model has been developed, an example I really like, in Norway by the National Digital Learning Arena. It's a Norwegian public repository for content where every year they run tenders which are open to market players. And they seem to support very well also small companies that want to create content, but the requirement is that this needs to be an open content. So I will wrap up slowly for the moment. I have some other issues, but I want to make two points. Another is lifelong learning. I think this is a perspective that has been very visible in this conference, and for me it's one very important example where, again, openness can lead to reuse of resources, you know, that move from formal to informal education, from higher education to lifelong learning, and especially in Poland where we have limited resources, this seems to be a very sustainable way of thinking. And last point I want to make, and maybe we can return to it, I think the situation is very different in countries, so-called developing countries. I personally don't like the term, but it's a good descriptor. So just to give one example, the Polish model has been, to a large extent, copied in Kyrgyzstan, the general concept of the digital school model. And they have been also developing open resources and an open resources policy in sort of an environment that's very different when it comes even to issues like access to broadband and even to equipment, and in some cases, electricity. So I don't feel I'm completely sort of, I don't feel completely secure talking about these examples. I feel Poland is in a very different part of the world, but I want to make note that I think this model is universal, and UNESCO has been working a lot in other places in the world to develop this.
Thanks, Alex. So you said something I wanted to ask a quick follow-up on. You mentioned that a model that you had was to take public money. You put out RFPs to have somebody else build the content for you with an open license requirement on it. In the United States, this was done twice in the last year and a half with about 50 million US dollars to do the same thing, to put out RFPs, have K-12 OER built. And in both cases, the American Association, this is not being recorded, right? Is this, maybe it is. I guess this is all public information. The American Association of Publishers organized the big publishers in the United States, Pearson, McGraw-Hill, Cengage, et cetera, to boycott those RFPs. So New York State put out $40 million for what they called Engage New York. It was curriculum, and they had a Creative Commons license requirement on it, and they were boycotted. So nobody replied. Then there was a project called the K-12 OER Collaborative. It's now called Open Up Resources. They also put out an RFP, and the big publishers boycotted. Now, so that's the sad part of the story. The happy part of the story is that in both cases, smaller publishers that were also for-profit came forward. Sometimes small publishers that were for-profit entities, in some cases it was, you know, the math department from the University of Utah that said, we're happy to build sixth grade math materials, and we're mathematicians, and we're also authors for textbooks, so we're fully capable and qualified to do it. So that was the success story. With a little bit of friction, we were able to get past that boycott. So the reason I bring that up is I know in Poland, this was not smooth sailing. The publishers in Poland and the International Association of European Publishers pushed back on you in Poland and then pushed back at the European Union level. Could you tell that story? Because I've been asked this by many people at the conference. You know, what is the response from the incumbent publishing community as we move into OER? So what happened there?
So just to clarify, the publishers, yes, were very strongly opposed to this reform because, just to make it clear, in the previous model, they knew all the content will be purchased in the market from them. So basically, since textbooks are obligatory, there was a certain market size. It was around $250 million, which was the size of their market. And it was a secure market. It's a very sort of comfortable business situation. It's also a situation where I believe the government, for this reason, has the right to regulate this market. And what happened in Poland is basically publishers were fearing for the future of their publishing model, which is I try to understand their perspective as sort of a fair thing to do if you're a business. But this led to a very sort of, I would say, heated debate. And in the end, what happened is the publishers, as you described in the US, sort of boycotted the tenders, which were handed out to public institutions. There was only one case, and it's interesting, because it was a pretty big publisher. It was the biggest purely Polish publishers, because most of them by now in Poland have some mixed ownership. And this one is a purely Polish publisher, a relatively big group, which created the textbooks for early education, grades 1 to 3. There's an interesting story there. They have their own sort of set of resources, traditional ones, 1 to 3, slowly making them digital in some form of PDFs, usually. So what they did is I think it was a very smart move, but I appreciate that this innovation kind of solved the problem. They created an interactive textbook, which doesn't have the form of you cannot print it, really. It's more, it feels like a game for children, basically, an online game. It's pretty simple. But so I think their strategy was trying not to compete with this resources they're building for the government with their own sort of resource stack. I really don't have a problem with that.
So in the end, you were able to hire a for-profit publisher,
yes,
to build the open education resources.
They built around a quarter of the resources that were being built,
right,
which was a good story. But in general, the problem remains, I think, and it only gets solved, for instance, at the moment that ultimately the Polish government decided that the existence of digital textbooks will not mean that they are removing printed textbooks. This means this wasn't, in the end, an extremely progressive strategy. To be honest, the reason they did it was very simple and it was smart. We just don't have sufficient equipment. If Poland switched to pure digital in schools, we wouldn't have enough laptops, tablets, we wouldn't have really pedagogy models. So for now, we have a mixed model. And this mixed models means textbooks are still published for purchased from publishers, which sort of immediately makes them step back. Of course, the best thing the government, I think, could do is try to negotiate with the publishers to incrementally make them release some of the resources openly. So maybe not the textbook, but the resources for teachers, or supplementary resources like lesson plans, test scenarios, and so on. We're not seeing that. It's a pretty complicated strategy that you need to have and be very strategic about it, and be very good at negotiating. But this is a model we would like to see. We think in far in the future, the most sustainable model will probably be based around digital resources. Poland by 2020 has promised to provide fiber connectivity. It's a good step that might mean we'll be getting better infrastructure. Until we get that, it needs to be a mixed model, and it probably requires cooperation with the publishers. So just to wrap up, sorry, I'm speaking pretty long, but I believe this, when this conflict happens, I have very strong personal views on which side I am. I believe in public funding of open resources as the better model than procurement from the market at high prices. But I think an improved model is where this can be negotiated. So for me, the success story is that after really heated discussions around 2011, in 2015, I launched with my colleague Marlena Plebańska sort of a bottom-up process where we created a working group to discuss sort of a new concept for digital school and digital education. And it was a multi-stakeholder approach. So we brought IT business, we brought the publishers, we brought school principals and educational experts and civil society organizations to one table. And we managed to write a document that maybe didn't yet include a recommendation for CC attribution, which I would love to see there. But it included language that supported, to some extent, openness of resources, which I think that's the win, where we managed to find common ground.
Great, thank you. So I'm going to ask one more question of Joe, and then we're going to open it up to the audience and your questions, and we'll have a conversation. So, Joe, I want to come back to SDG 4. And I'm going to read for the audience, there are many points in SDG 4. I'm going to read two, 4.3 and 4.5, because they both focus on equity issues. So 4.3 says, by 2030, ensure equal access for all women and men to affordable and quality technical, vocational, and tertiary education, including university. 4.5 is similar to that. It says, by 2030, eliminate gender disparities in education and ensure equal access to all levels of education and vocational training for the vulnerable, including persons with disabilities, indigenous peoples, and children in vulnerable situations. So given those equity statements and big goals in SDG 4, talk to us about specifically how can OERs specifically, and open education more broadly, help us get to those goals.
Yeah, that's right. Okay, well, thank you. Well, first I would say that even more than the 17 SDG goals, and even more than the targets underneath them, it's really interesting to look at the indicators, the 169 indicators there, and what they imply for member states in terms of their reporting. So, for instance, in the ones you cited, the indicator 4.51 requires what are called parity indices. You in the audience probably know more about it than I do. You know, so female versus male, rural versus urban, bottom versus top wealth quintile, indigenous people, disabled people, and draw out those numbers. Yeah, this is actually happening. This is actually happening when we look at the annual UNESCO report. The UNESCO is a lead agency for SDG 4. We already see a great amount of data. I mean, some of it sort of feels self-evident, but it's there. Where, for instance, in Afghanistan, you have double the literacy among men as girls, and so on. So. The very fact that we have these SDGs that are addressing equity for the first time offers, you know, as Cable said, it offers opportunities for OER. You know, so in this instance, I mean, I can maybe Cable can think of many more, but in this instance already, we can look at OER at the most basic level, which is which is the element of remix or revise, so that you can adapt a curricula to maybe include audiovisual elements for disabled people, or to address, or to translate, to address, to reach minority groups in indigenous languages, as well as to take elements from different textbooks that are OER and build something useful for women, particularly women in the, well, not particularly, but women in the STEM fields and so forth. And those types of OER elements appear to exist. I mean, you've probably heard this many times, and I guess I tend to have like a rose-colored kind of la vie en rose kind of attitude about this, but yesterday, Cable showed in his one of his slides the growth of OER and you know, just to give you sort of the quick backstory. So in 2002, OER was the term was coined at UNESCO. By 2005, the Creative Commons statistics, their yearly reports, showed there's approximately 50 million Creative Commons licensed things out there. 50 million is not trivial. 10 years later, you know, on that chart, it was just blew right off of it. But I think it was at 1.3 billion there. I think you mentioned 1.5 billion. That's a 30-fold increase. You know, that's exponential. In fact, when I looked at the growth of internet users from 2006, when maybe many of us first had our Mosaic browser or Netscape browser, it took 17 years to achieve what happened in Creative Commons. So something clearly is happening, yeah. And of course, you know, it's the obvious caveat that Creative Commons licensed goods aren't OER. OER is a completely, it's clearly a subset within that. But as many people discussed yesterday, whether they're talking about learning from YouTube or searching on the internet, you know, when I think Cable said this, but when you, or I think I overheard him in a conversation saying it, but when you search on the internet for common terms like supply and demand or any sort of Euclidean geometry, Pythagorean theorem, mitosis, you know, like cell division and so forth, the majority of your hits are OER. And if you think about it, I mean, the mathematics tables, geometry, these are OER by definition. I mean, there's no, I mean, how many ways can you teach multiplication, really? There are plenty of resources out there. So when we address these gaps, these clear gaps that are being identified more and more through the SDG process, you can see elements where OER's value as an essentially no cost to reproduce product comes in. You know, I mean, you don't need teachers who radically change the way they work in terms of remixing and revising. When you talk about lifelong learning, you can see the value. I think Josie yesterday talked about how some children were working with, they had contracted somebody to develop a tablet app, and some children came up with ideas that were adopted, essentially like, well, we don't think that snack is so tasty. What if you changed it for this and so forth? That type of learning goes beyond just the foundational numeracy literacy that prepares people to be lifelong learners. In fact, it strikes me as ideal. So while, you know, looking at the big picture, OER is kind of at its very maybe early stage, you could say. I mean, it's still in need of many champions. You know, we have champions sitting next to me. But you know, there may be champions sitting in this room. Hopefully, you know, it's something that's clearly there, phenomenally huge, and it's it's tracking very well with increase in smartphones and how that's projected, which may be the principal means to access OER until broadband catches up in LDCs. Something is definitely happening in the world, and that's very reassuring. And you can see throughout the MDGs, just line by line, how different aspects of the five R's that Cable speaks about could make a big difference in these countries. Well, another example that I would make is that you may not know this, but during the Millennium Development Goals, LDCs increased their funding for education, increased it by $3 billion in aggregate. And yet, we had a very difficult decade, difficult funding environment, and conflicts and so forth, the gap to achieve universal education increased. It actually increased by $10 billion, right? That's not an easy problem to solve as such, but when you think about the benefits of no-cost OER, the benefits of sharing South-South and so forth, there might be something there for OER in the SDGs. And maybe at some point Gasper can talk a bit about the upcoming World OER Congress, because we're trying to, the goal is to mainstream OER, to further mainstream OER, highlight best practices. And part of that is leveraging the fact that the SDGs need us. I mean, they need many things. They need many tools and ideas. Linking to the SDGs, something that's been adopted at the highest levels of government, may provide that inflection point where OER becomes much more commonplace in our lives. It might not happen, but it could just happen around the corner. All of us are at the genesis of it, and it depends on how much we believe. I mean, not all of us. Cable, but we are. But there are other champions out there, and there are opportunities to work together so that things can be done on less of a linear path and less on a pilot by pilot basis. And all those elements are potentially there. I hope you agree.
Thanks, Joe. That was very helpful. We had one last slide, but I'm not going to put it up because I don't want to blind my colleagues. We titled it, "What Can You Do? What Can Your Government Do in Particular?" Should we put it? Can you turn it back on for me? And then we'll turn it back off. It's all good. We are nimble, open people. And then we're going to turn it to, we've got about 15 minutes for questions, and we'll have a discussion. See if we can get this up here.
It's warming up.
All right. Well, I'll read the first one to get us going. So the first thing is to build ICT infrastructure for the search and discovery of OERs. So there are international OER repositories that already exist that you don't have to build. You can just use and point at them. What many of your universities are already doing, but not all of them, is your librarians are creating curated sets of OER for different disciplines at your institution. So it's quite common for a librarian to create, here's all the great OER for chemistry. And they tell your faculty, these are the top reviewed open textbooks for chemistry. Here are other faculty reviews for around the world. Here are the top five courses in chemistry, et cetera. And that way your faculty at the universities don't have to take a lot of their own time going out looking and trying to find things. The librarians curate those sets and make it easier for them. So that's one thing to think about, is it's not just the technology, but it's also it's the people. It's how can we make it really easy for faculty and teachers to shift to OER. Another thing is to support collaboration of educators who want to build, share, and adapt OER. There's several ways to do that. And you're welcome to take pictures of the slides, but we're also going to, of course, these are openly licensed, and Alex will put them on the website for the event under an open license. So you can download them and feel free to reuse them if they're useful. So there's a lot of ways to support educators. Sometimes universities are hiring OER librarians who help faculty find OER. Sometimes instructional designers who design courses with faculty are being trained in open and how to find Creative Commons licensed works, and those are being worked into the classes. Some universities are giving faculty release time. So faculty say, I really want to do this, but I don't have any time. I need a quarter of my time or a third of my time for a few semesters to redesign and rebuild my course. Sometimes this is about awareness raising. So many countries have OER, national OER seminars or a conference that you open up to every educator in your country, and you invite government and civil society and business to come to that. And everybody, it's a bit of an awareness raising activity, kind of like these 2 days have been for all of us. Lots of other ways you can support faculty. We've talked about this one at length. You should be looking into which funding sources go out of your public funds channels through grants and contracts. My recommendation is to start with discretionary optional grants. If you put an open license requirement on optional money and somebody complains about it, you can say to them, it's optional. We're not forcing you to apply for the grant. We're not forcing you to apply. This is a competitive grant, and if you don't like these terms, don't apply for the grant. It's a very easy conversation. And you can also say, this is taxpayer money. This is public money that we're using. And as the government or as the university, we believe in getting the highest return on investment, having the most impact when we spend public money. And that means that we're going to require an open license. And that's why. And if you want specific language and documentation, Creative Commons and others have built all of that. So you don't have to write any of that. All you have to do is email me and we'll get you everything that you need, including training for your staff if you're interested in doing this. And I think all three of us have talked about why this is important. Just to give you a statistic, in my country, in the United States, in higher education every year, our students spend 10 billion US dollars a year buying textbooks. And for that amount of money, 2/3 of our students don't have the books that are required for the courses. That's what we're spending, and that 10 billion is 1/3 federal money, so it comes right out of the federal government in financial aid. It's 1/3 state money, which is also taxpayer public money, that comes out of state grants for financial aid, especially for low-income students. And 1/3 of it is the debt that Brian was talking about in his keynote this morning. That's why one of the reasons why the United States is $1.3 trillion in student debt. So we have whole generations graduating where they may never get out of student debt. So it's almost impossible for these people to be, if you're doing an economic analysis, they don't have money to buy a house. They can't buy cars. They can't be consumers. And many of our country's economies are driven 60, 70% or more by a consumer economy. This is one that Joe talked about at length when we were talking. Ensure accessibility of OER for persons with disabilities. We know that good design, and when we're thinking about accessibility, it's not just for people with disabilities, it's for everybody. When we design things well, when videos are closed captioned, when we have alt tags on images for screen readers, when we don't use red and green to show information because if you're colorblind, you can't get that information, right? That's just good design for everybody. And then we talked about using OERs to achieving SDG 4, but we've had several conversations about OER being used to support all of the SDGs. So if you think about the SDGs, clean water, reducing poverty, climate change, all of these SDGs are going to require educational resources, right? In your country, you're going to need to educate people about what each one of these things means. There's no reason why all of that couldn't be openly licensed and shared. Imagine Europe working together to create open educational resources that could be shared across the EU about all of the SDGs. And then we've had a lot of fun talking about, imagine the future, and I talked a bit about this yesterday, but imagine going into a university class as a student and having your assignments actually being work on the SDGs as you're learning physics, as you're learning chemistry, as you're learning biology. So let me stop there. We've talked enough. We want to hear from you. If you've got a question, just throw a hand up. I'll bring you a mic.
Thank you very much. My name is Karin Omosa. I'm from the ETUCE, European Trade Union Committee for Education. Thank you very much for your interesting presentations. You asked about what's our opinion of the open OERs. And I think that the trade unions, of course, we support what you're talking about and the equity dimension. But still, I would like you to comment a little bit on, there is a fear, I think, among our member organizations for the risk of marketization and commercialization of education, and also a risk of loss of professional autonomy for teachers in higher education. Actually, in November, we adopted a policy document on ICT. We had this conference, the Regional Conference of Europe. I would like you just to read you a short statement from that, from the unions in Europe. And it says like this, market control is one of the reasons why OER may be misused to promote commercialization in the education sector, to reduce public funding, or to increase managerial control over teachers and academic staff. Teachers, however, should have the freedom to select and use teaching and support materials which they believe to be appropriate. Education policy has to assume the responsibility for adequate public funding, for quality, for transparency about origin and funding, for professional orientation, and for an inclusive use of e-learning. Governments and education authorities should ensure that publicly funded educational materials are available through open licenses and that OER contribute to the reduction of education barriers and social disadvantages. So what I want to say is OER can be used in many different ways, and it also depends on who pays for them and who has the... Yeah, you understand me. Can you please comment on that?
Yes, so first, thank you. And would you please email us that statement and the link to the document, because we'd really like to have that and share that. So the statement had two interesting clauses that caught my attention. One was essentially the preservation of academic freedom, right? And then the second, you had a final statement about, it's a good thing to require that publicly funded resources be openly licensed. And the first thing, and I don't think anybody said this yet, I certainly haven't at the conference, is that when those of us in open education, we never, ever suggest that OER should be mandated. We always start with academic freedom as the principle. And the good news is that, and you also use the word maintaining, or the phrase maintaining professionalism of faculty and teachers, which we are also firm believers in. And the good news is that with OER, like you said, it can be used any way you want. You could be somebody who takes OER and mandates it, and that would be a violation of academic freedom. That would not be good. But that's not the ethos, that's not the philosophy of the open education space, right? We always start with academic freedom as the starting point, and the professionalism of teachers and faculty as the starting point, and to preserve those and to enhance those through OER. So the first thing, whenever I'm sitting down with university chancellors or presidents or provosts or deans, and they say, oh, we're very excited about, we could have, all of our textbooks be OER and all of our courses, and we'll create one version and we'll force everybody to teach with it. And I always say, no, don't do that. You'll just really upset the faculty. And it's not helpful. And you don't have to do it. OER is about more choice. It's not about less choice. And so I think the right way to work with faculty always to preserve academic freedom, for all the right reasons, is to, for faculty that want to use OER, we support those faculty who want to move. For faculty who are not interested in moving to OER and they're very happy with their commercial textbook or resources, then we leave them alone. We say that's fine. Over time, most people do want to come to OER. The other thing you get with OER, just to state the obvious, is the open license. So from a professionalism and academic freedom standpoint, the open license gives faculty and teachers the legal rights to change the content to make it exactly as you want it for your class, which is a professional activity, right? I'm the professional, I'm the subject matter expert, I'm the teaching expert, I know what my students need. And what they need is something different than what this resource is, and so I'm gonna change the resource to provide the right thing. And so the openness not only provides more choice, but provides those rights to do what you want to do as faculty. Mm.
I'm not so worried about faculty, but what I'm worried about is sometimes that governments have high expectancies of cost reduction. Yeah. And that's another question that I think has to be discussed.
Can I just clarify this, and also based on the Polish example, because I understand your worry, but I don't think it's fully warranted. And I also want to say that when Cable speaks about academic faculty, I think the same arguments apply to schools where, for instance, most of your teachers are. And I think, yes, there is this challenge that sometimes OER can be seen as cost-cutting strategy, but the costs you are cutting are the expenses made to purchase commercial resources. So I think actually, if done smartly, you are releasing costs that, for instance, could be invested, and that's our argument in teacher training. What we see in Poland is 98%, that's the research wasn't great, but it gives you some figure, of teachers are by now dependent or very well made, but sort of monotonous, homogeneous resources provided by publishers. When you get the commercial pack, there's everywhere there. It solves certain issues of teachers who have too much work. A lot of them are not well paid enough, and that's some excuse that they're really looking for the simplest manner. But education is hurt because they just follow, they just take what's given to them, and these 98% more or less provide very sort of tailor style education. And what we're trying to say, and Cable said this very well, that with open, it's also a process where you're encouraging a bigger group of teachers to work at personal level, to adjust their teaching, to make this effort, and not just say, oh, I got this textbook to all these materials, it's a big book, and I'm gonna go through it.
One final point, then we'll go over here and then here, is that when we're talking about money and OER and cost savings, oftentimes the phrase that's used is to budget shift. So we used to spend a lot of money over here on expensive textbooks, now we don't have to spend that, and then the teachers are involved in the decision making about where that money can be reallocated. And it might be teacher raises, it might be smaller class sizes, it might be more pre-K kindergarten, it might be more resources in the classroom. But at least in, I know of examples both in Canada and North America, that's actually happening right now. And that's a very positive thing where teachers are part of the governance over deciding how that budget shift happens. Let's come here.
Okay, my name is Peter Seitz. I'm working for the Ministry of Science and Research in Austria. And first of all, I have to say our interest is not to lower costs. Our interest is to spend the money for the universities and not to spend the money for the big publishers, and to maybe lower the raise of costs for the big publishers. That's one aspect. Then we in Austria, we do have academic networks. We do have cooperation projects among all universities in Austria to develop open educational resources. We do have a platform which is called Forum New Media Austria, and all universities and all universities of applied sciences are member of it. Okay, but one aspect I'm missing is we should have used these 3 days of conference not to convince each other whether open educational resources are bad or good. we should have thought about how to make all these national efforts fit together and make all these national efforts more visible to the academia of Europe, so that maybe Austrian students can go to a British or an American or a French homepage and to take their contents. That's one aspect. The other aspect is the university professors, the teachers, they develop their open educational resources, but they develop their resources by taking pictures, by taking graphics out of other publications. And there, the big question is: are they allowed to do so? I think
no.
Most, so I know yeah. And I think therefore most of what is done nowadays is somehow illegal.
I would say most OER is not illegal, but most copying that academics do is illegal. Yes,
okay.
I would agree with that.
And the big problem, the big European problem, is that not the authors will be affected by the big publishers, but maybe the universities, because the universities they have money, and therefore by affecting them the big publishers will gain money, and therefore a European copyright law which makes it possible for the professors to do so would be very, very important. And the third aspect is for the licensing and the open educational resources. If nowadays all rights are fixed to the teachers, and if one teacher leaves the university, then all the materials are lost for the university, and therefore we should have to gain more awareness about this problem, that all these materials which are funded by public money stays in the competence of the public.
So that last point is really important. We talked about efficiency of creating, distributing, and using educational content, but you put a fine point on what happens in universities, and this happens all around the world. Faculty come in, university pays them a salary, they build a course, faculty leave. Oftentimes the contract is ignored. So oftentimes the university holds non-exclusive copyright, and the faculty holds non-exclusive copyright, but the faculty or the university doesn't actually hold on to a copy of the content, and the content's gone, and then you have to rebuild it. And that's very expensive. In many cases, like you said, the contract says the faculty own all the copyright and the university owns nothing. In that case, if the faculty don't want to share, they don't have to share. It's quite common in K-12 that the school or the school district or the country holds the copyright and the teachers are work for hire, but that's not true in every country. So before you look at this issue in your country, the very first thing you should do is look at the contract between the educator and the institution. And whenever I'm asked for advice, I always suggest that essentially joint copyright be given. You give non-exclusive copyright to the educator, and you give non-exclusive copyright to the institution, and then either party has the legal rights it needs to put a Creative Commons license on the work. And then the convention, the culture, is usually, not always, but usually that the university or the school says to the teacher or the professor, we're not going to put a CC license on the work. We're going to leave that choice up to you. And then there's awareness raising and sharing about why these are good ideas, and then some faculty will share and some will not. But if those faculty leave, like you said, they've got a copy of the content, and then sometimes those universities or schools will openly license it at that point. So everybody has different methods to this, but you make an excellent point. We don't want to lose content and have to rebuild it over and over. So we're past time and the coffee break is set up, but the rest of the people haven't showed up yet. So I think we can take a few more questions. And I think it was here, yeah, here, and then around. So we'll start here.
To continue on your, yes, on your, because it's important. Especially regarding to the Poland project, and as you know the EU talks a lot about sharing best practices. So, for instance, you're talking about IPR, who owns the open, in your RFQ, for instance, the IPR, who owned that? Would the company who created this content, how open was it? Would they be able to sell it in other countries, for profit? And second, how did you control the indirect marketing? Because obviously, I always believe people don't do anything for free for nothing. So there's some indirect marketing. Is it allowed? Is it good? And what about sponsorships? Are they allowed, in fact? They have their corporate social responsibility and they might fund, obviously it could be something like Google or like Microsoft or like, but it's all increasing the for instance, the digital capacities within a country.
Should we get maybe collect more questions? Are there any other, I know there's some hands up. Do you want to?
Actually, a comment.
Why don't you give a quick answer to his question?
Well, the quick answer is that the IPR stayed in the end with the government, but most of the content was made by public institutions. But also, since it's a CC attribution license, any can make use, including commercial use of it. And since this was publicly funded, there wasn't really an issue of sponsorship, but I want to note that there are models. For instance, in South Africa, open public textbooks were done in a model where basically they were sponsored in exchange for a logo. It was seen as a good deal, if it can get really high quality resources to schools. So there are different models.
Yes, I'm Patrick Kamler, I'm from the University of Malta. I think that you have really hit the issue on the head, because when we consider open education resources, even when it comes to publishing in journals, you are given two options. You either publish, or else you pay in a journal, or else you have to pay so that it would be available freely as an open education resource. Strictly speaking, I wouldn't know who will be getting the money. Because reviewers, I'm a reviewer. I'm not paid for what I do. So we have to do something about that, because unless you publish, you won't get promotions. So if you write something and you make it available freely, then it won't get you anywhere. I think we have to make pressure, even on publishers, or create sources, like, for instance, ResearchGate, where publishable material or material which is up to standard can still be reviewed without having to go to the publisher's houses.
So that's a whole field called open access. And we've got a lot of resources we can help you with, but let's take it offline. Let's talk during the coffee break. But basically, three quick answers. Funders, governments that fund research, and research units like the Max Planck Society in Germany, and the Wellcome Trust in England, and the Gates Foundation that funds global health in Africa, they all have open access policies that say you must publish in an open access journal. Usually there's a 12-month embargo, so publish wherever you want. After 12 months, there must be a public version available that anybody in the world can read at no cost. And then the new updated, better open access policies require zero embargo period, so the public can read it immediately, and they require a Creative Commons attribution license on the article itself. The reason for that is that scholars have to be able to do what's called text and data mining. So for example, I'm an ed psych professor, or ed psych is my field. If I wanted to read all the ed psych articles that were published in 2016, it's impossible. There's over 100,000 of them. I need my computer to go do an analysis and make a derivative work and bring me back a report. By doing that, I've made copies. I've implicated copyright. I need an open license on those articles in order to do that kind of research. And so Gates now requires CC BY license on the articles, And then the last thing that we want is open access to the data, the research data, and we dedicate the data to the public domain using CC0. And that way other researchers around the world can get those data sets and replicate the studies. Let's go to the next question. Gaspar?
Thank you. It's not a real question, but in line with your last slide that you have shown, and the question what governments can do for OER. I'm Gaspar from the Slovenian National Commission for UNESCO, and thanks for the presentations and this debate, but I think it's the best room to make this announcement, because all of this debate will of course be debated also during the second World OER Congress, which will take place in my home country in Slovenia from 18th to 20th of September this year. And this Congress will have major goals. It will not only debate the what happened to the Paris OER declarations, declaration from 2012 up to today, but it will give big room to probably create and to formulate recommendations on how to use OER and on elements of international cooperations in the field of OER, also in regard to how OER can support SDG 4, but also in general. But the second goal would be also, that is the question, what can governments do? Because many governments are in wish of this idea. Probably the debate will go also around how UNESCO, this global organization, could probably adopt a international instrument, so a recommendation or a convention or something like that for the usage of OER internationally. So this big questions will be debated during the World Congress. Presently there are regional stakeholder and expert meetings taking place. The next one will be in probably 4 weeks' time, taking place in Malta, in this premises. I think all of your governments have received official invitations. Also formal invitations to the World Congress itself will follow very soon. So I hope, and it will not only be invitations to governmental representatives, also to stakeholders, to experts, and to the community itself. It will not only be a formal program, but it will have and consist out of several side events, giving room for really all fields that are of importance in the field of OER. Thanks for listening.
Since, can I just, I also need to make an invitation. These are big formal events, but when there's a need to have more in-depth discussion among practitioners and government officials, I want to invite you. I organized in Warsaw in June a small event called OER Policy Forum. It's a lot more, not grassroots, but it's very informal. It's just an opportunity for around 60 people working in open and digital education, government officials and activists, to meet and talk. If any of you are interested, please talk with me, and I would be happy to have you in Warsaw.